workshop series, lecture by Karel van Nieuwenhuizen in our series called Practicing History in Super Diverse Societies. Today we will be discussing the way in which history education works within super diverse classrooms, what the challenges are, what the dilemmas are, and also what the history is a bit of thinking about this issue. This is why we have invited Karel van Nieuwenhuizen, who is the head of the educational master at the KU Leuven history department. He has been writing and thinking about, for example, the use of or the discussion of colonial history in secondary education, especially in Belgium. We've read his pieces, or at least some of you have, last week, and I'm sure we have plenty of questions for him, but he'll first be giving a 45-minute presentation on the topic. So thank you, and welcome, Karel.
Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you for your interest in today's lecture about secondary school history education in Belgium, Flanders, and the way history education deals with ethnocultural diversity since the end of the Second World War. Let me just begin with some quotes. This quote stems from the Ministry of Public Education in Belgium and is from 120 years ago. And this circular letter says, "May the teacher feel the love for the nation in his heart, and may he be persuaded of a deep respect for the national institutions and sincerely attached to the constitutional freedoms. If the teacher incorporates the living sources of patriotism, it will be easier for him to fulfill his duty. Out of satisfaction and of duty, he will seize the opportunity to work at the patriotic upbringing of his pupils." Clear aim. This is a quote from 20 years ago, again from an official document stemming from the government. This is a quotation from the history standards from 2000. "Historical education makes an essential contribution to the formation of personal and social identities. This education should support students in these personal and social quests, so that the study of history offers them the opportunity to discover and understand their own and other identities. In other words, an education that allows students to grasp the integrated coherence of human activities in a given society. This also means relating one's own culture to other cultures." And this is a third quote. This is a consideration from the consumer end, let's say, of history education in Flanders. Chopri Ben Chica, a theater producer who attended secondary school history education in Flanders. And he was asked about his experiences in that history education, and he says, "They," so the teachers, "they knew very well at school that I was of Arab Muslim descent, but they never went into that. And my parents had far too little education to pass this on themselves. Education could have done more. Very simple example, I only learned very late that there are Arabic words in Dutch. I also had to discover on my own, thanks to the parents of an ex-girlfriend, the golden age of Arabic history. There had been universities where Christians, Jews, and Muslims taught philosophy and languages together. I had never been taught that." Last quotation, very recent one, from a speech of Theo Franken, former Belgian State Secretary for Asylum and Migration, Flemish nationalist politician, an 11th of July speech at the Flemish holiday. He says, "What we need is a Flemish education that uncomplicatedly and in a positive yet nuanced way initiates the students in our Flemish language, culture, and history. It starts with a new canon of history in which schools can communicate the achievements of our culture and history to young people in an open-minded way without, however, turning a blind eye to the dark pages of the own history. At the same time, more attention should be paid to Flemish artists at school, from Jan van Eyck over Emil Claus to Michael Borrelands, via a canon of Flemish art. And what better way to stimulate the youth to curiosity and entrepreneurship and by giving them the examples of the Flemish top inventors who changed the course of history and the life of mankind itself. Leo Bakeland, Paul Janssen, and so on. By introducing our children to the shining examples from the arts, science, and history of our own Flemish community, we can make students proud of Flanders in a truly positive way, whether they are newcomers or native, and at the same time make them dream of more. That's where it all starts." So as you see, as you can see from these four different quotes, You see that educators and curriculum builders in history education are confronted with some major questions, being what is history education for? What should be the major aim of history education? Second pressing question, what and whose history should be taught? Third pressing question, what kind of identity construction should history education support? And these three major and very important questions become even more pressing when taking into account, since 1945, the ever-increasing ethnocultural diversity in history education. If we look at history education, not only in Belgium, Flanders, but also worldwide, or at least in the Western world, you see that, broadly speaking, one could say that there are that history education faces three competing expectations. And each of these expectations brings about a different scope in content selection, brings about a different conception of identity, and also brings about different values that should be imparted to young people taking part in this history education. One expectation is history education should contribute to nation building and social cohesion. And the major aim is then instigating patriotism among young people. The identity formation is focused on national groupness and group loyalty. And the focus, the content focus, is then on the national past. A second, and that could be considered as the other side of the same coin, a second expectation is that history education should contribute to democratic participation and civic engagement. Here the content focus is not on national history but on global history. The identity formation that is aimed for is not a national identity but a global commonality connectedness. And the values that are imparted to students are civic values, social resilience, and so on. And then a third expectation for history education in some countries is that history education, in the first instance, should initiate young people in a disciplinary understanding, in a historical thinking, in which the specific content does not always completely matter. The idea particularly is that they should think historically, that they should understand both past and history. Not only the past, but also how our representations of the past are being built. Here, the emphasis with regard to identities is on self-understanding social location, not on groupness, not on connectedness, and also includes some kind of deconstruction of identity formation processes. And so you see these are three different expectations for history educations with some overlap, which I always indicate, but nevertheless, three competing expectations. And so taking this framework or this scheme into account, these are somewhat the guiding questions for this lecture. How has been dealt with ethnocultural diversity in history education in Belgium, Flanders since 1945? And I would like to look at this question both from a content-related perspective, what kind of histories are addressed, who is attributed agency in these stories about the past. And then the second perspective is, I want to look at this question from a student perspective. What kind of identity markers are offered in history education? To what extent has attention been paid to intergroup dialogue? And what kind of value transmission is present in the different curricula in different time periods since 1945? And so as you see, this, of course, this relates to the whole question about what is the main goal of history education. And I also want to contextualize this within the different political and educational contexts since 1945. Sources The sources for this lecture are primary sources, history, cultural standards, textbooks, and also secondary sources. There has been several scholars have written about this. Starting from this question, I can distinguish four different time periods in which in each of the periods a number of things in history education changes. So here you see them, and these are the four periods that I will address in the next half an hour or so. An important preliminary note before I start the actual historical overview concerns the legislative educational context in Belgium. Belgium is characterized by a very liberal constitution stemming from 1830, in which freedom of education has been established. This means that as a result, education has been organized by different, both private and public educational networks, and they enjoy a strong autonomy. Like, for instance, they have the right to draw up their own, they had the right to draw up their own curricula in an independent way. And the role of the state was rather limited. There was a state inspection that played in different times a bigger or a smaller role, but nevertheless there was a strong autonomy for the networks. And so the major aim of history education and what should be the content of history education was not defined by the state but by the networks. What was the main aim of history education soon after 1945, after the end of the Second World War? Well, this main aim was in line with 19th century history education. History education had to foster Belgian patriotism. It had to support a Belgian identity in the sense of groupless construction process. For instance, a quote from a history textbook for secondary education from 1948, imagine that you would read that today. This was the last sentence of this textbook for secondary education. May God bless the nation and its royal house. This is something with our present day eyes. Flanders, Belgium, we're not used to read that, certainly not in history textbooks. This is a literal quote from 1948. What was the content focus in that history education soon after the Second World War? The content was very Eurocentrically oriented. And secondly, there was a big focus on Belgian history, which was taught separately from general history. And general history was European Western history. Almost one third of the curriculum of history education at secondary level was dedicated to Belgian history. And in this Belgian history, a pantheon of alleged Belgian heroes was presented. And the idea was that this pantheon of alleged Belgian heroes should enable young people to learn from those heroic examples from the past, for the present, and for the future. And this was the idea. But after a few years already, by the end of the 1940s and in the 1950s already, this whole idea of history education supposed to support the Belgian identity construction process comes under pressure. And it comes under pressure from different angles. First of all, you have proponents of regionalism. You have the Volksunie, the Flemish Nationalist Party. You have the Rassemblement Wallon, Walloon Nationalist Party. And they attack this Belgian-inspired history education. And they say history education, as it is some kind of anachronistic reprojection or back projection of a Belgian nation's feeling in the past, which was actually not there. You cannot suppose a Belgian identity and a Belgian feeling of a Belgian coherent feeling before 1830, and this is what history education does. And this relates to a lot of debates about, for medieval times, for instance, what should be the focus, the County of Flanders, the Duchy of Brabant, the Prince Bishopry of Liège, and so on and so on. So, from a regional point of view, Belgian history education comes under attack. But it is also attacked from an international point of view. International institutions, such as, first and foremost UNESCO, but also the Council of Europe, they criticize nationally inspired history education a lot, saying this has been a cause of war, both for the First World War and for the Second World War. So we should stop by emphasizing a national perspective in history education. They also say a nationally inspired history education is an impediment for international reconciliation. In addition, what also plays on the background of these debates are the problematic national memory of the Second World War here in Belgium, because of the widespread collaboration with the German occupier, particularly within Flemish Catholic circles. The whole memory of the Second World War and how to deal with it becomes very ideologically charged and very communitarian. And so this is very difficult for educators in their thinking about how to deal with that. So from these debates, the consensus slowly grew while the national past should be taught embedded in an international framework instead of being taught in a separate way. This is a consensus that slowly grows. But then the question raises, of course, but what international framework? And here you see a divergence between the left side and the right side of the political spectrum. On the left side, and this is inspired by UNESCO, also by peace movement, by decolonization movements, the left side of the political spectrum sympathizes with the UNESCO point of view, saying, well, history education should take up a global and contemporary perspective. The underlying values imparted by history education should be peace, universal human rights, pluralism. The identity formation that should be striving for should be a global identity and sense of connectedness. I always refer to the article Beyond Identity from Brubaker and Cooper from 2000. And they say, well, identity, that is some kind of very vague concept, and then they differentiate between different other concepts related to. And so also UNESCO says, well, all philosophies of life are equal. And the left side of the political spectrum embraces that. The right side, including many Catholics, rejects that. For many Catholics, this really is a bridge too far, that Christianity or Catholicism should be treated equal like every other philosophy of life, indigenous philosophies of life in other parts of the world and so on. So they adhere more to the point of view of the Council of Europe. The Council of Europe is far more fan of the creation of European identity in terms of European groupness, feeling part of a group and distinguishing between the in-group and the out-group. This Council of Europe also wants a Western European approach to the past, so not a global approach, but the focus should be on Western European history. The Catholics say Christianity is superior to other philosophies of life. And here, in the Council of Europe, with their focus on Western European history, neglects to a very important extent any Western, non-Western intercultural interaction. And then the question is, okay, what is the outcome of these debates between the left and the right side of the political spectrum? Well, the outcome is very clear, although at the first glimpse you should think otherwise. This is a quote of the history curriculum for general education of the Catholic Network of 1961. So here they state, well, you can read it while I explain it a bit. Here they say, well, our ambition is that students should study societies in their own logic. We should not wait for Europeans to come to other parts of the world and only then start to study the civilizations being present there. No, we should do it. We should already study societies in other parts of the world in their own logic, in their own right, even before the arrival of Europeans. But so this is the aim, especially for the upper secondary level. We should In other words, we should not take a Eurocentric approach anymore. This is the theory, because if you look further in this specific document, this history curriculum of 1961, and you look at the contents, I have not translated them, but you will see that the emphasis is mainly, not to say almost exclusively, on Western and Western European history. There is only one mention here, a contact with the old cultures of America and Asia, that refers to non-Western and non-European history. And so you see a big difference between the aim and the actual contents. This has to do with what historians of education call the grammar of schooling and so on, but I will not go into that. It simply says that it's very hard to change, to bring about change in an educational system, because curriculum builders, and teachers and educators are used to do what they do, and if you want to change something, this is very hard, because even changing stuff, they will try to turn that in such a way that they can continue what they have always done. And here you see that with the contents, these are contents that you already found in the 19th century as well, and here in 1961, you see them again. This is 1961. In 1964, another curriculum of history from the educational network again for technical education. And here you see already a shift. Here the major aim is more aligned with the actual content, because they say history will therefore be viewed from now on, from a new point of view, Europe. Because all Western European peoples share the same legacy, the same experiences, and the same creations. You see immediately the crudeness at stake here. So here the concern is no longer with the global view. So they say, well, we emphasize Europe, and then they show some concern about this European perspective that they take, but no concern with regard to a lack of a global perspective, but rather with a lack of a national perspective, because they say, however, this view does not exclude the knowledge of, and now you would expect, global history. No, it does not exclude the knowledge of our own national history. So you see, there's still a struggle with this nationalist approach from the 1940s and before. This is from the curriculum. This is a small quote from a textbook already from 1956, in which you see that this is very Eurocentric in the sense that Europe is the agent, and that Europe also serves as the standard to judge other societies upon. The European states managed to conquer and colonize most parts of Asia, and so on and so on. But the yellow, brown, and black race successively come to self-awareness and independence, the way the white nations demonstrated that. So here you see, we, the West, we are the example, we are the standard to follow, and those retarded races, finally, they move up towards our ideas and our being. So the outcome of the debate is very clear. The emphasis, both in Catholic education, but also in public education, is on Western history, on Western agency, and is very Eurocentrically oriented. Anton de Baat, in his doctoral thesis, even speaks of social evolutionism within history education. He says, well, Western peoples in those textbooks and curricula are being represented as pioneers of history, traditions and achievements of non-Western peoples are ignored. Nevertheless, we do see, compared to the 1940s, a shift from Belgian patriotism to Western identification, from a Belgian groupness to a Western and a Western European groupness. This is, so nevertheless, you see a change within the 1950s and 60s. And this shift, this change, and that's interesting to see, this coincides with an increasing labor migration from North Africa and Turkey. And also, young people with those origins entering the levels of lower secondary education and technical education. And this is interesting to see that in that time period of the 1950s and the 1960s, the composition of the classrooms change. They become, in certain regions at least, more multiculturally composed. But this is, however, not taken into account in the debates of the new history curriculum. Not in terms of content, but also not in terms of, okay, but how to deal with this multicultural presence in the classroom. No didactical suggestions or whatsoever are being mentioned in these curriculum. So non-Western presence was not thematized, ethnocultural intergroup dialogue or how to deal with this diversity was not fostered at all. Nevertheless, in the 1960s, a left-wing group of educators and state inspectors, like for instance Leopold Flamm, they start to undermine this consensus and they start to critique that. They say, they start to critique the very Western oriented content focus of history education, and they say, we wish to contribute with all our existence to the concrete, real emancipation of mankind. The best and only way to realize this is to foster the reflective atmosphere of a school in which our students, by means of, among other things, history lessons, learn intimate and sincere respect for others, whatever their color, faith, or conviction may be. In a second quote, the child's environment encompasses the whole world and all times. So they start to plea for and propose a planetary view on history with the aim of raising students to self-conscious, emancipated, democratic, critical, and responsible citizens. In their opinion, history education had to be socially relevant and therefore also had to be presence-oriented. They define four spatial spheres, which should be, each of the four should be addressed in history education: the Atlantic, Western sphere, but also the communist sphere, the former colonies, and developmental countries. So they really plea for a global perspective in history education. But again, as you see in these pleas, the non-Western presence has not been thematized. This is from the point of view from a homogeneous, white, Belgian composed history classroom, not from the idea that you have different, that you have people from different ethnocultural backgrounds in your classroom. And this is not present in this in these ideas. This group of left-wing educators, they are somewhat the precursors of a large educational reform in Belgium that takes place in 1970 with the introduction of the so-called reformed secondary education. And this reform had been inspired by a democratization paradigm. The aim was that more young people should be kept in secondary education, or should enter secondary education, should be kept there for a longer period. The second aspect of this democratization paradigm was that young people should make a choice of study not according to their descent, the plumber who becomes a plumber and the lawyer who becomes a lawyer, no. The choice of study should be done according to the capacities of the interest of all young people themselves. And so the idea of social mobility. And the third aim of this reformed secondary education was to raise young people to critical citizens. In this whole idea of this reformed secondary education, history education itself comes under fierce attacks, it comes under fire. The critical voices towards history education as it was say that, well, history education in its current form is antiquated, is outdated, is even anti-modern. It only has little civic or social use. It's not sufficiently globally and present-day oriented. For instance, why would we learn something about ancient Egypt as if we can learn from the ancient Egyptians for today? So let's just ignore them. We don't need history education to install a truly democratic society today. So the strongest critical voices make pleas for replacement of history education by social studies. And they want to remove history education from the curriculum. The response of history educators is that they start to reorient history education towards a more presentist and moral approach of the past in the new curricula. And the so-called Enlightenment values are being put to the fore very much. Human rights, respect for democracy comes to underlie the history curriculum. For instance, ancient Greece has been studied in a lot of textbooks, and the angle is, okay, in what kind of way is slavery in ancient Athens completely not in line with the Human Rights Declaration of the United Nations, for instance. So you see very anachronistic ways of dealing with the past, but this is the very moral orientation and presentist orientation of history education. History education also has to, according to these educators, has to contribute to the rejection among young people of discrimination and of racism. History education is expected to allow young people to draw lessons from the past for the present and the future. And in line with these aims is also an idea that raises much more than before, that the emphasis in history education should be on skills and the critical assessment of sources, for instance, and so on, rather than on contents. And what we will see is, up until today, that these two debates merge while they are not completely the same, and one can go without the other, but nevertheless, these debates really become entangled with one another. What was then the influence of these goals on the curriculum? Well, there is an influence. If you look at the content of history education in the 1970s, at least in the reformed secondary education, you see that the attention for non-Western and global history really increases. They talk about the consciousness of the African elite, the Islamic réveil, and so on. At least these were topics that before 1970 were never addressed, so you see some kind of shift towards other content topics than before, and others, not only Western contents anymore. The motivation here, again, is autochthonous students should learn about other cultures. The idea is not, we have to address the multicultural composition of the classrooms. No, this is not the issue. The idea is, so the starting point again is a homogeneous white classroom that has to be that has to learn about other cultures. So again, the increased multicultural composition of the classroom with this labor migration from the 1950s, 60s, 70s, and many more of those young people also come to the classrooms also of history as a result of this democratization process of secondary education. But this is not thematized in the history curriculum. What we see then is that the attention for the non-Western world and cultural relativism increased, also according to this doctoral thesis of Anton de Baetz. He also shows that the ambition of history education clearly is to install some kind of global identity in terms of commonality and connectedness. But then on the other hand, he says, well, okay, these are the aims, and you see a little bit of change, but nevertheless, overall, there is still a continuation of Eurocentrism. In a lesser form, nevertheless, there is still social evolutionism present. And thirdly, all students become immersed in a Western perspective. And there's no such thing as multiple perspectivity in these textbooks. The perspective is a Western one. And here you see two excerpts from textbooks again. This one, industrialization caused the hunt for raw materials and markets, and so on and so on. This explains why the African nut was shelled. If you look at this, this is not about Africa, this is about Europeans in Africa. The only agents in these text excerpts are European countries. And it's as if Africa is terra nullius, or no people live there, or at least they are not attributed any agency. And here again, you still see this very stubborn Eurocentric idea about the West being the standard to judge other societies upon. German rule propagated the cultivation of commercial crops, such as silk, coffee, and cotton. The indigenous farms, however, were technically not sufficiently developed, and so on and so on. So you clearly see who the standard is and who is judged upon that standard. This is particularly for the 1970s. In the 1980s, new debates about history education, not that fierce debates as abroad, but nevertheless, new debates arise on history education. In other countries, such as in England and in France, very fierce debates take place on what should be the role and the orientation of history education. And this is clearly linked to migration flows, which have been very extensive in those countries, and a growing and increasing multicultural society. And these debates are really mixed with debates on contents versus skills. On the right side of the political spectrum, in many of those countries, advocates plea in favor of reinstating a Western European focus of history education. Liberals say, well, Enlightenment values should be put to the fore much more. Catholics continue to reject the idea that all cultures are equally valuable. On the left side, advocates still continue to reject the bare existence of history education. They continue to say history education should be removed, and they prefer social studies to history education. In Flanders, the debate is not completely the same as abroad, in that sense that while in other countries history education, like in France and in England, continue to exist, history education in Belgium was really threatened. And the idea really was to replace it by social studies. The number of hours a week devoted to history education were decreased a lot. So here the debate was not on, well, was to a certain extent, of course, on the orientation of history education, but was first and foremost on the position of history education itself. We should remain, we should keep some kind of history education. And so the pleas that were made here were particularly to remain history education rather than to choose for a Western European or a global approach and so on. So the debates in Belgium were far less connected to migration and to multicultural society. At the same time that a debate about history education was going on in Belgium, there was also an identitarian debate going on, just like abroad. But again, this identitarian debate was not that much related to the multicultural society and the presence of migrants, but was much more related to the Dutch and French speaking communities and the communitarian line of fracture, not to the whole idea of multicultural society. So you see, this is some kind of red line throughout the story that is, to a large extent, as regards history education, is completely ignored. At the end of the 1980s, in 1989, to be more precise, education becomes regionalized. Belgian education, and in extension Belgian history education, ceases to exist. The regional governments become responsible for education. So from now on, I particularly focus on Flemish history education. Education and also history education becomes the responsibility of the Flemish government now, and contrary to the previous Belgian tradition, they decide to intervene more in education, because in the 1990s the Flemish government aims to establish standards. So they want to impose from the government standards on education, minimum targets that should be that should be held by students at the end of every stage of secondary education, so at the end of grade 8, 10 and 12. This is seemingly a big rupture with before, where there was far less government interference, but then on the other hand we should not exaggerate that, because in the end standards committees have been established to write new standards. And you see that in those committees, experts, educational networks and functionaries are present, and interviews with all of these people present in these committees have shown that they have never experienced any party political interference. So in the end, the rupture was not that big perhaps than as you would suppose on first glimpse. Furthermore, the different educational networks were still allowed to draw up their own curricula, of course based on the standards, but nevertheless though they still had a certain amount of freedom to do what they wanted to do themselves. History education. After the big debates of the 1970s and 80s, should we keep that or should we remove it from the curriculum? Well, it becomes part of the basic curriculum for secondary education. The new standards for history are being approved by the Parliament in 1969 for grades 7 and 8, and the Parliament is satisfied with these standards. They say, okay, you don't see any obvious leftist indoctrination, so that is okay. History education contributes to citizenship, that is also okay. The focus on the Western history and a Western European frame of reference is also okay. Here you see that the national past completely evaporates almost of these standards, but this is not object of any debate. Just a few days before the final vote on the standards, some Flemish nationalist politicians request to include in the standards a specific final attainment target on Flemish identity in terms of groupness again, but this is ultimately rejected by the other parties. So how do these standards then look like? Well, the standards, they put to the fore a double aim for history education. And you see that this is a compromise between the societal expectations towards history education from the leftist, from the left-wing educators from the 1950s, 60s, 70s, emphasize societal goals for history, and then a compromise between those civic aims for history education and disciplinary aims for history education. And this, because in the debates in the 1980s about should history education be continued or not, a lot of historians intervene and say, well, they demanded respect for the way historical knowledge has been constructed and so on. So you see that in these new Flemish history standards, this is a compromise between the two. So the double aim is, on the one hand, history education has to introduce young people into the academic discipline of history, particularly in how they should engage with historical sources. And then on the other hand, the second aim of history education is its civic ambition to prepare students to be part of society. By four different aspects, young people should gain historical consciousness, young people should get cultural training with a specific focus on the way in which people from European and non-European societies perceive their reality, and on the basis of their perception of that reality, shape its future. They also should get social resilience training, and history education should also support young people's identity building. And this is a shift compared to the previous period. Identity here is conceived as self-understanding and social location, and not in terms of groupness anymore. They say history education should support young people in their search for who they are individually and as a social human being, but they do not put a specific identity to the fore. So no groupness anymore. The underlying values of the history curriculum are still focused on democracy, human rights, and enlightenment values, freedom and equality. If we further look at the curriculum does not put any contents to the fore anymore. The focus is much more on critical thinking skills and attitudes rather than on contents. Teachers have been given a lot of freedom to choose the contents they want. The basic frame of reference is still a Western-oriented one, but nevertheless, these new standards acknowledge the Eurocentric character of history education. And they also show the ambition to go beyond it. And so they really identify this Eurocentric character of history education as something that is, to a certain extent, problematic. And they say we want to go beyond that, and therefore they establish the obligation to address in each year of secondary school history education to address one non-Western society. One of the final attainment targets states the students are able to define fundamental characteristics of one non-Western society in a given period. So this is really the ambition to go beyond a very Western-oriented history education. This is the ambition of the standards. If we look at the history textbooks and concrete actual classroom practice, we see that this aim has not very well been adopted. Because and I see that from my own students when they do a pre-service training. Several teachers tell me, if you send my student, I will have him teach the history of Japan or of China and so on. Because, if the lesson isn't quite that good, that's not really a problem. The students don't have to learn that. If I look at certain history lessons, the teachers start by saying, and today, young people, we are going to do something completely different. We're going to talk about Africa. So the non-Western world is really considered a bit as an exotic curiosity. And still what you continue to see is this persisting Eurocentric approach. This is a quote from the first sentence in a lesson on Japan in the 19th century. In 1850, so the lesson starts in this textbook, Japan still was a feudal state. And the word still is very significant in this context, needless to say. What you also see in many of these textbooks is that the agency and the perspective continues to be mostly Western. And of course, this has its so you see the standards say there's an obligation to address one non-Western society per year. In practice and in the textbooks that doesn't really work out fine. But what is not addressed in the standards nor in the curricula, that is the increasingly multicultural classroom composition. And this is completely ignored. In the standards, so the standards are being shaped in such a way that they cannot really offer any didactical suggestions to teachers. The curricula of the different networks, of the different education networks, they can do that and they actually do that. So several pages in these curriculum documents talk about didactical suggestions, how to fresh up the classroom and what kind of didactical activating activities might one do and so on and so on. But what is not talked about at all, that is how to deal with the multicultural classroom that you are facing in a lot of cities and villages and so on. So this remains to be completely ignored. As a result, perhaps, you see nevertheless that young people history education should support the identity building process among young people. But in practice, you see that history education continues to support, particularly, a Western identity formation. from research that I have been done and that others have been done, you can clearly see that, you hear that resonating while students talk. I did a lot of focus group and individual interviews with 18-year-old young people just finishing secondary education, and all of them, and they claim to be open-minded world citizens. There's and everybody is welcome here and so on, but nevertheless they draw identity board boundaries between what they call the progressive and free West and the regressive Arab world. For instance, so a very ethnocentric reflexes, like for instance freedom of education, they start to talk about that spontaneously and they say, yeah, well, we here we have that, but they there, they still consider religion there to be very important, so the us versus them thinking is really nearby in their minds. Some students from minority groups, not all of them, but at least some of them, indicate that they do not feel any sense of belonging in history education. They say, this is not about us. It is as if our history does not matter. Mm-hmm. And they really show feelings of alienation. You also heard that Ronnie Mosuse, for instance, in his search for his father's history, came to me and asked me face to face, how come that I never heard anything about Congolese history during 6 years in secondary education in Flanders? Can you explain that to me? Yeah, this is a slap in the face, of course. So this shows somewhat the idea that I try to explain here. And then, last stage, in 2019, so last year, September the 1st, new curricula, new standards have started to take off in history education. In 2014, with the, at that time, new Flemish government, this new Flemish government announced a new reform of secondary education. They said, well, the standards are more than 20 years old now, and it's time to revise them because society has changed, ICT skills have become more important, and so on and so on. But what also has become more important for the Flemish government is they said secondary school programs should become much more aligned with the needs of metropolitan diversity. And where does that come from? Well, of course, first of all, from the metropolitan reality, but also, at least I think so, from the fact that post-colonial migrant groups, more than before, started to raise their voices. And they really started to say, that, and how about us in the whole story here? Contrary, so, and then when this idea of revision of the standards was announced, the Minister of Education, Hilde Kerwitz, encouraged that Flemings would discuss the contents and the orientation of the different subjects and so on. And then you see that with regard to history education, several groups or several institutions that include migrants and migrant groups, they start to take initiatives and they really start to raise their voice. In the Africa Museum in Tervuren, for instance, African diaspora, together with scholars from the museum, they really had a round table talking about how should history education look like. So post-colonial migrant groups really start to raise their voice on the Flemish nationalist side, contrary to 1996, where in the final vote towards the new standards, they wanted to include something about Flemish identity. They remain silent. You don't really hear these voices. Okay. So the idea is that to align education in general, but also history education, much more with the needs of metropolitan diversity. And then the question raises, of course, how can you do that? There are a lot of possibilities for doing that. What you could do is, like in Russia or in Texas, for instance, that is, well, how can you align history education with the needs of metropolitan diversity by restoring an ethnic-inspired national perspective and just exclude every other perspective and thinking, well, everybody has to adjust to that. You can also combine a national and Eurocentric perspective, as is the case in France. You can continue a Eurocentric perspective, as was the case in Belgium. What you could do is take the example of California, for instance, where they, in the curricula, provide a multicultural history, but within a national history framework. And so the emphasis is on national history, but they really discuss and debate the contribution of different ethnocultural groups to that history. You could compare it somewhat to Histoire Mondiale de la France, for instance. Another approach would be the world history approach, a completely centerless history, so to speak. Still another approach is the history of intercultural contacts as an important engine of change in the past, as William McNeill, for instance, emphasizes. Well, these were all kinds of ideas that were discussed in the committee for developing new standards, of which I was part, and Bruno for the second and third stage as well. What was very striking is that there was no... first of all, how was the committee composed with history didactical experts, people from educational networks and functionaries? Again, no specific political interference. There was immediately a consensus on the fact that history education should go beyond Eurocentrism and provide a more ethnocultural inclusive education. So this was not a point of discussion at all. The idea that we should take into account multiculturally composed classrooms and that we should go beyond a one-sided Western perspective of the past was completely taken for granted. This was considered even self-evident. The question then raises, why did no one change the existing curricula then based on this self-evident idea? I don't know, but nevertheless, so this was not the object of debate at all. In the end, we have chosen to include somewhat the history of the approach of the history of intercultural contacts in the history in the new history standards, and because you have to choose something nobody was really fond of a purely global history approach. For instance, in the Africa Museum, several scholars there in that debate in 2015 were fan of that. And they said, every region and every country in the world should be addressed in history education. Well, perhaps that's a nice idea, but if you start to think about it, every region, every country of the world, I don't know any history educator, including myself, that has the knowledge to talk about all these issues. Furthermore, there's also something as historical significance. What would be the significance to talk about the history of Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and so on, if you have no young people from that region whatsoever in your classroom? So this centerless history was not considered to be the best idea. We chose to be inspired by the history of intercultural contacts. And a useful framework in that respect has been developed by Nicolas Standard, who is a scholar of Chinese language and region studies. He examined representations of early 17 Chinese European contacts by historians, by Chinese, by Western European historians. And this is very interesting because what he finds can be applied very well to history education textbooks and so on. So he distinguished between four approaches that, as I just said, are very recognizable within history education and textbook representations as well. Furthermore, these four approaches give inspiration about content selection, about give also excellent didactical indications, and also provides inspiration to deal with identity markers in education. So when you looked at how different historians wrote about this Chinese-European intercultural context in the 17th century, he said some of them really adopt a transmission framework. So the perspective is clearly a Western perspective, and the main question is how did the West, how did Europeans change China in that 17th century? The sources are exclusively Western sources, and the agency is solely a Western or European agency. And the other, the Chinese in this case, are only passive receptors. A second framework, other historians, well, they adopt a reception framework. They are going to look at how did the other receive the West. Here, the sources of the other are analyzed, but nevertheless, the other, and the focus is on the other, but nevertheless, the other is a reactor to an initial Western actor. And so you still see not really multi-perspectivity. A third framework is the invention framework. Still other historians ask the central question, how did the West create a symbolic representation of the other? So again, in a meta-perspective nevertheless, but again, Western sources, the other as such barely comes into the picture. A fourth framework is the interaction and communication framework, which counters the one-dimensional character of the previous frameworks by looking at both parties and see the differences within each of these parties. I'm not homogenizing them. So these historians, they base their work and their analysis on sources of both parties. They attribute agency to both parties, and they also examine reciprocal representations of the other, of the Chinese towards the Europeans and the Europeans towards the Chinese. And here in this framework, a Eurocentric view on the past is broken through. What is also important, what is also very interesting with regard to this, these four frameworks, is that each of them also holds a specific conception of identity in it. In the transmission and reception framework, there is a clear us versus them contrast. An identity is considered to be stable and unchangeable, because the Europeans remain Europeans and they change the Chinese, but nevertheless the Chinese remain purely Chinese and the Europeans European. So a conception of identity as being stable and unchangeable. In the invention framework, well, this is a pure focus on the we, while in the interaction and communication framework, what we see here is that it fosters dialogue, it recognizes the multi-layered character of identity, and also it deconstructs identity building processes. This, in this framework, it becomes clear that us and them are not unchangeable, but actually are dynamic and changeable. And these historians show that, well, Europeans in China start to adapt a lot of Chinese rituals and so on, and become some kind of mix of European and Chinese. And these historians also show that throughout these intercultural contexts, new communities, so to speak, start to occur, and new identities arise. And so this is, in my opinion, a very interesting way of dealing with things. Nicolas Tombart, for instance, compares identity with a closet. Identity in terms of self understanding and social location. He compares that with a closet with slides. And he says, yeah, well, as a human being, you don't really have one identity, you have different layers of identities. All these slides are part of a layer. And depending on a specific context, if I'm here, well, I'm the same, but at the same time, I'm also a bit different when I'm at home, when I'm with friends, and so on. And so he says the slides can change places. Also, he says, this might be your idea, but if other people look at you, they might focus on one of these slides only, and not see the whole of your identity and of self-understanding. Furthermore, he says, what is important is that young people should start to look at their identities as such a closet. which is changeable. Huh? You can replace the slides, you can remove them, you can add them, and so on and so on. So a dynamic view on identity. So in these new standard, in these new history standards, they have adopted this intercultural contacts framework to a certain extent. What is, for instance, still present is that the periodization that has been suggested in the standards is still the traditional Western historical frame of reference, with the time periods, prehistoric times, and so on and so on. We have tried to counter that by saying that young people should know alternative and should also be aware of the consequences of using a traditional Western historical frame of reference. The historical key concepts used in the standards are as generic and are held as generic as possible. We don't talk about Western European medieval society of rank and order or class society or caste system. Because this standaardmaatschappij, Western European medieval society of rank and order, is typically a Western European issue. If you want to talk about other societies, you cannot really use this term. So we talk about layered societies. And the new standards include request from teachers and their students that they study both Western and non-Western societies, but also, and this is the difference with the previous standards, also the intercultural contacts between them on different levels. There's also the obligation to take into account multiple perspectives, because otherwise you still risk that only a Western perspective is used. The standards also instigate the awareness among students of their own positionality and of others' positionality in talking about the past or in giving representations of things that happened and so on. And they also foster critical reflection on collective memories and identity construction. By way of conclusion, you see that the ethnocultural diversity in history education, in historical perspective, in terms of content, you really see a shift. In the 1940s, 50s, a Eurocentric approach combined with a national focus. From the late 1950s onwards, you see that an awareness raises about Eurocentrism. And in the 1960s, 70s, the answer is, well, we should move up towards global history, from a Western perspective still, but nevertheless global history. In the 1980s, you see a return to Western history. In the 1990s, you see a new attempt to go beyond Eurocentrism by requesting that at least one non-Western society is addressed. And a new attempt to go beyond Eurocentrism nowadays is this idea of intercultural context. But we will have to see what comes out of that, because the new standards are only launched in the 7th grade last September. As regards the multicultural classroom, as such, multiculturalism has not been thematized throughout the 1940s until today. The focus still was on the autochthonous classroom. In the new history standards, the existence of the multicultural classroom has been recognized. We'll see what the consequences will be. Nevertheless, what you do see throughout the last 7 decades is that there has been a shift in identity approach from Belgium, from fostering Belgian groupness, over fostering global commonality connectedness, and then in the 1980s again Western groupness. We have moved to fostering a critical self-understanding, social location, and a critical identity deconstruction. Normally I would have ended here, but very recently with the new Flemish government, installed in October, they have announced the establishment of a Flemish historical canon. And then the question is, of course, how is this canon idea, can you reconcile that with the approach of the new history standards, as I have just explained it? And perhaps I'm very sharp in my distinction between both, but while the history standards put historical thinking to the fore, the Flemish historical canon, fosters some kind of ahistorical and anachronistic thinking by back-projecting current-day Flanders to the past, where Flanders as such did not exist. While the history standards foster a critical, multi-layered self-understanding, social location, and also attempt to deconstruct identity processes, The Flemish canon is geared towards Flemish groupness. Contingency versus teleology, inclusive multiple perspective versus exclusive and one perspective. You see that in the examples. We should show the great accomplishments of Flanders, but so be it, you can do that, but if the only examples that you give are white, male, supposedly Flemish people, the idea is clear that everybody else has nothing to do with the assumed greatness of Flanders. And this is what I mean with this exclusive character. The new standards clearly want to present history as being a construction and an interpretation, but if a canon says, well, we should show facts of history and so on, it seems as if they will present history as a fixed truth. In the history standards, we want young people to take distance from the past, and the past as a foreign country. The historical canon suggests proximity. We should take pride in the past from several hundred years with which we have nothing to do, but nevertheless we should take pride of that. And the history standards propose a historical frame of reference, while the Flemish historical canon, it is said, we take the Dutch example with the 49 windows as an example. But if you talk with Dutch history teachers of the upper secondary grades, they say, well, this Dutch canon only creates historical fragmentation, because it's really cherry picking here and cherry picking there, but there's no clear line. They don't see the larger picture of a broad history beyond the Netherlands. So the outcome of all these debates are not clear at all, but I would like to end my presentation here, and apologies if I took too many time. Well, thank you very much for listening.